Ladies and gentlemen, good evening and welcome to another edition of PZ85 Plays. I am your Game Master Double H, and a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away, we began a brand new episode in the Star Wars Dawn of Defiance campaign. Once again, welcome to the show and thank you so much for joining us. If this is your first episode, you picked a great time to be here because tonight we begin episode 7 of 10, the final episode of Act 2 of the Dawn of Defiance campaign, A Reckoning of Wraiths. Before we get started, let's quickly introduce our cast, beginning as always with the creator and co-owner of Podzilla 1985, playing Harani Tar, it's Shannon Young.
I'm Space's heartthrob.
Down below, we've got the man himself, Tanner Calvert, playing our resident Jedi, Craig Halen. Nope. Sigurd Talon.
I
was going to screw it up sooner or later. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I got Craig on the brain after last week, man. Inquisitor Sordidum.
Sodium.
Anyway.
Sodium.
I don't know, what's the secondary to a resident Jedi? Cody Sandusky playing Kruskog Zubane?
I'm not sure, but this is the cradle of Imperial civilization.
And of course, our Bothan spy Iris Nae, played by Lindsay Wolfgang, the only sane one among us, and that's why we keep her here.
That's still debatable.
That's fair. That's fair. Totally. As Cody alluded to at the end of episode 6, of which the final installment took place last week, which you can go back and hear right now at podzilla1985.com, the core of corruption came to an end with our heroes collecting the information about the Sarlacc project they needed from the Amici Spire. Cody leaving the scene and then coming back to tell us all about it. I don't know what happened there. Surviving an encounter with a former friend, Craig Halen, now known as Inquisitor Sordidum. In the aftermath of that attack on the Amici Spire and the destruction of it, the heroes succeeded in escaping with their lives, but just barely, only to find that the holonet has lit up with footage that the Empire has leaked that appears to show them as terrorists. They were taken in by a crew of revolutionaries, a crew of loyalists who are rather excited. In fact, they're basically fawning over them to have them there. But it is certainly setting in for some of them that there is no going back now. Their old lives are gone and the rebellion has now begun. Shannon, you had something to say.
Yeah, I forgot to update the graphics, so we're 2 levels behind. And then Cody just doesn't want to be here.
Well, that's because you just updated the graphics finally for the last game, so...
I'm about to update my status, and my new status is shut up.
So, for the record, now that I know that's the case, we are level 13. Our heroes are level 13 overall. Again, we're getting very close to 20 is where they top out, and typically you gain about 2 levels per major episode. So we did that a few days ago, got everybody leveled up, except for Sigurd. We did that about 2 hours ago. But it's done. It's done. It's ready. I hate to move too much further without Cody, and I still don't know what happened to him because he hasn't messaged us. So we're going to sit tight and see what's up. In the meantime, how are you guys?
Let's give a quick recap of what happened in the ending of last week for people that...
Oh yeah, I guess I should mention that rather than just kind of glossing over it. Yeah. At the very end of that episode, again, as one of Kruskog's contacts on Coruscant, Taro Reskon, a Syrian woman, had taken everyone into sort of a, not underground literally, but very much a hidden away, safe house, basically. Everyone kind of had their own little endings. You know, Graz had a very humorous, he was covered in dust from the Amici Spire, so he looked like the Abominable Snowman. Excuse me. Iris and Kruskog went off with Taro to transmit the Sarlacc Project information to the Resurgence, back to Admiral Varth and Captain Varana. But 2 very particular things stuck out at that time. Oh, do we get a message from Cody? There it is. All right, he's restarting his computer. 2 very particular things stuck out at that time. And if you saw the opening crawl, you've actually already gotten a little information about this. But we'll recap that in just a minute for everyone's sake. 2 of our heroes encountered some major revelations. First, Sigurd was made aware after this encounter with Kraid that, according to the Inquisitor, they are brothers. Now, whether or not that is true, obviously, is debatable, but it appears that they are from the same family. According to Inquisitor Sordidum, he said that Sigurd's real name is actually Thalen, not Talon, and so that has left him thrown for a bit of a loop. The two of them have always known very little outside of the Jedi Academy, but evidently the Inquisitorius saw fit to share with him some information that he did not have prior to that. Hirani, on the other hand, was quite, how do I put this, distraught, I guess, to a certain extent, at finding that her celebrity has now turned against her. For quite some time, she's been able to leverage that across the galaxy as the famous Hirani Tar. She's now the infamous Hirani Tar, and at the very end of the episode, one of the revolutionaries had tapped her on the shoulder and got her attention and said, it's been some time. And then we cut to black. So Hirani appears to have rekindled an old relationship that we're going to find out more about very, very soon. As soon as my throat stops freaking, I don't know what this is. I don't know what's happening here right now. Excuse me. Good Lord.
You got plenty of time.
And Cody gets back.
Yeah, you got plenty of time until Cody gets back. So
he's got to restart that computer. I believe he's using a gateway from 98, if I remember correctly.
Complete with Calbox.
Yes.
It's also,
we had said Calbox. It
it's also haunted. So.
Yeah. Yeah. Cody, is that nice, computer haunted? Please confirm.
It's got a nice crank on the side that you use to to get it going.
It's the old Victrola model. You got to give it the works.
Michaela said Shannon starts singing Spin Doctors. I don't know the lyrics to that song that I...
Michaela, no!
That I, Tanner, I'll start singing a different song. I'll sing all the songs. I'll sing the songs
that's
I like.
Said, yeah.
I'll sing the songs I like to sing, you know?
He'll sing the songs that make the whole world sing. Or write them, at least.
Where's Cody?
Yeah, why is he in here but the video's not working? That can't be good. Nothing about that's good.
Kodu stands before us over there. That's all I got.
Somewhere. He did say he was having some kind of trouble with OBS earlier, which can't possibly be good.
I don't know why he's using OBS for...
I don't either. Yeah, he's gone, though. He left again. That's good. This is good. This is a solid start. He's back. This so is can you at least get to us without the video?
Yeah, I'm actually on my headphones right now trying to reboot my
internet. Okay.
This is like this is like when Tanner pops into the Xbox Live party. We're like, Tanner, and then 2 seconds later, Tanner leaves the Xbox Live party. Bye, Tanner.
No, I joined a second ago and could not hear you guys. Like, it showed me I was in, and I saw your videos, but couldn't
hear you. It's Discord, man. We've had, every one of us has had at least one night where Discord just absolutely shits the bed.
If it's in Discord's slight defense, it may not be just Discord, but my entire internet at home. So your boy gets to do IT work, not at work.
That's good.
Well, then
you
it's not
to wait while you're.
It's not really IT work.
Nah, you're
then.
Good.
It's IT play.
Oh no.
No such thing.
That would make Jack a dull boy.
Yeah, something like anyway. That. No, you guys can go because I've got my headphones in.
So Cody, if you need help getting your Discord up, you know who you should probably talk to.
Ghostbusters.
No.
I was thinking more like Chong. Chong could be helpful. Okay. Well, with that recap in mind, again, briefly, I'm going to sneeze. I'm going to give Cody a second.
What's happening tonight?
All right, there it goes.
Everything that can go wrong may go wrong.
I knew it was coming. Okay. So, again, episode 7, A Reckoning of Wraiths. For those of you who did not get to see the crawl, if you're listening to purely the audio of this,
shame on you.
Oh, I edited it. I guess I should play it. I'm going to give you the original version without the specifics for those characters. But it reads, with the taste of victory still sweet upon their tongues, the heroes find refuge on Coruscant with loyalists. Following the destruction of the Inquisitor's Tower, the Empire is searching for the culprits with extreme prejudice. And just as there seems to be a lull in the action, word comes that one of the captive designers of the Sarlacc Project has survived and is seeking asylum with the loyalists. So, basically, this episode, A Reckoning of Wraiths, starts just a couple of days after the end of the Core of Corruption. In that time, you guys have been, squirreled away in this safe house on Coruscant. Safe, but it is not exactly comfortable. Tensions are high. basically the majority of the loyalists you find are just normal folks. They don't agree with the Empire's politics. They want to do something about it, but few, if any of them, are really trained combatants. One or two of them have, you know, some experience. One was like local police before the Empire took over. At least one of them did a little like bounty hunting work on the side, but never on their own. They were assisting other people. So these are not soldiers. These are political dissidents, basically. Intentions are pretty high for the most part, especially now that you guys are wanted by the Empire and you're here. And don't get me wrong, they're very congenial to all of you. In fact, I guess we discussed some in some cases last week, they've practically fallen over you. You guys are nearly legendary due to the stuff that you've done. It's very well known that you destroyed the Amici Spire. And in standing up to the Inquisitorius and walking away effectively victorious, they're pretty excited to have you there. On the flip side of that, every caller that comes to the door has to be examined. Every speeder that passes by on the street is suspect. If they go even a little bit slow, everyone pretty well goes into lockdown. So it's sort of a give and take. They're very happy to have you there, but at the same time, it is pretty distinctly uncomfortable in lots of ways. In the time frame that we're talking about, over the course of a couple of days, what are the sorts of things that you guys might do?
I'll start.
Okay.
Catch up and wonder what the F's going on.
Okay.
Actually, it's a three part process. Catch up with this person. Which, did we ever remember her name?
I thought you did. I was gonna leave it up to you to decide who that was gonna be.
Was it your original person?
Yes.
From way, way back.
Yes.
Ripley.
Ripley. Believe it or not, yep. Lindsay got it.
Good move.
So the
I mean, if not, I have it written down in a tray over
no,
there.
No, you're right. That's who it was.
The problem is that was a original character detail that was seven chapters ago. So
I've been holding on to it all this time.
And then it went on so long.
How
we just
think I felt that last game.
Yeah, it's that slow burn, man. Catching up with Ripley and just figuring out how the hell that she ended up here, because Harani's been looking for her. This is the reason Harani started on her journey, was to find her old friend who just disappeared. And now look at the trouble they're in. So she's doing that. She's also very much lamenting the situation that she has. She went from the galaxy's sweetheart to basically she's what's the woman's name? Patty Hearst. She's Patty Hearst in a sense. So. Oh, Michaela's
except
not
Patty Hearst was taken. No, would that. You? Yeah. Cody might not get that one. he's pretty young. I don't know. I don't even think he's listening. Now.
He's not listening.
No, he's coming back.
There he is. without getting into too much detail, because I'm going to let you handle the distinctive specifics of this, but Ripley has had almost as wild an adventure as Harani has. Not to the same level of infamy, don't get me wrong, it's all been very behind the scenes, but she too has been through lots of encounters with the Empire, meeting up with lots of these folks. She kind of has her own crew. It's weird in a way. She has like a little mirror crew sort of to your group.
Please,
like they,
please
they
tell
have
me
like a,
she has a Wookiee named like Bras or something. No, not Bras. That's a bad one. That's a bad one.
Zorg.
Bra? Not Bras.
Bras spelled Bras. Backwards. Zorg.
It's Zorg. Actually, it's the exact opposite. She has like a Celestin who kind of fills that same role. And he's just kind of like, yeah, like nobody understands what the hell he's trying to say at any point in time. Yeah, she's kind of got her own little crew. No Jedi among them. No Force sensitives.
No,
you guys find you two, Kruskog and Sigurd find that there are actually no other Force sensitives in your immediate area.
Look at you, snowflakes.
No trained soldiers here. No trained soldiers here. But yeah, Ripley has quite a few tales to share with you, and you find it surprising that the two of you kind of slip back into this old routine over the course of a few hours.
Well, they grew up together. They were best friends. They were on the Tatooine. I mean, they lived the scummy life, and they both came out of it. It's just Harani did it through fame, and Ripley just kind of disappeared, and Lord knows what happened to her.
If you're looking for a reference point, it is very Steve and Bucky It's very Cap and Winter Soldier, sort of. They're coming back together years later. Ripley's the only one who kind of doesn't treat her with the level of, oh, gosh, it's Harani Tar. She hits you with the sarcastic, like, oh, it's Harani Tar. Who's special, you know? It's that sort of dynamic.
I think at one point Ripley said it was just, she told Harani, it was just yesterday you were pissing yourself. You know?
She said she remembers the last time that you left. She said, you know, not to do anything stupid while you're gone. And you said, how can I? You're taking all the stupid with you. it's that sort of dynamic. And it's Harani, I would imagine, kind of finds herself of two minds on this because she's not the same person she used to be. Occasionally she gets really comfortable with this and things seem really good. And then every once in a while she's reminded as a speeder slowly goes by and everyone drops quietly. I mean, this is full on, not to get too serious with this, but this is Anne Frank style. Like, people are full on hiding at any sort of unusual movement outside because you guys are probably among the most wanted people, definitely on Coruscant, if not in the immediate system and or galaxy at the moment. So we'll keep that in mind and we'll come back to that. What would the rest of you have done in this time frame?
I figured would have been trying to make some kind of contact with Master Denia.
Okay.
Whether through comms or through the Force, just trying to figure out what the hell was that about?
Denia specifically never comes through, and it's frustrating for Sigurd because there are a few times where he grapples with the possibility mentally that she is actively cutting him off. It's sort of that thing where you call somebody and it rings once and then it goes to the voicemail and you go, well, they just silenced that call. That's definitely what happened there, right? So without actually incurring any you know, dark side power, to go with game terms, without actually incurring any, you know, dark side gaining, there are a few times where he grapples with his faith there, basically. He's never actually fully able to get through to her, but there's a lot of time spent meditating and a lot of mental reflection on what does this mean and does it mean anything? Is it relevant? Just because, you know, this person who is a family member of mine has gone down this path, it doesn't mean that I will. Just because they're related to me doesn't mean that I have to, you know, that whole blood is thicker than water thing is commonly mistaken. It's, you know, the blood of the womb is thicker than the water of the, or the blood of the covenant is thicker than the water of the womb. It's actually the other way around. And so there's a lot of back and forth for Sigurd as well. A lot of emotional turmoil for people in the group here. Who else?
Before I jump in, I just want to say out of character, thank you for acknowledging that phrase is often misconstrued to the
opposite. Yeah, it's backwards.
It's supposed to be. Yeah, yep. Always.
Yep.
I greatly appreciate that. No, a Kruskog is going to, having been in this situation, or at least a similar enough situation for a while, he's kind of used to the vibe of making himself unknown, making himself kind of quiet and disappear amongst people. So that's more or less what he aims to do right now. Meditate in the sense, not quite in the way of Sigurd, of trying to contact anybody, but try to draw him from within. Keep a peace about himself after encountering what is the starkest opposition in the Force he's encountered in a while. You know, Coruscant, he's been dealing with Imperials on the scale of, he knows they're evil, obviously, but not so much in terms of there actually being an opposition in the Force to counter what he's been striving and working toward, even after all of the events for the Jedi the last so many months and years. So he needs some time to kind of bring some stillness back to his spirit, and that's his goal, alongside kind of taking care of the day-to-day, kind of being in this community of people that are hiding but also aspiring for a greater good. He's going to try to do what he can around the compound, but pretty much just stay low.
Yeah, though the two of you and that is Kruskog and Sigurd, have the most in common in that sense, I suspect there's very little crossing of paths over these couple of days because you're on two very different journeys there. You know, yours is a much broader, larger galactic sense of, is the Empire perpetrating this dark side of the Force? Are they directly tied to it? Why do they allow the Inquisitorius to exist? Whereas Sigurd's is much more personal on a much smaller but more intense emotional level of, it's not just that the Inquisitorius exists, it's that it is currently, you know, it currently maintains one of his supposed direct family members.
Yeah.
So yeah, yours is a much more galactic mental readiness over that time. Iris, what about you?
Iris is very much in the state of mind of, okay, the shit has hit the fan and we need to know what we're doing next. So she's very much in, what do we need to do to get through this and get out of here? So she's kind of the people that we've met, seeing who can still get out and find information for them and trying to make a little bit of a network so that we're not just completely in the dark.
Oh, yeah. I suspect Iris is 100% the most pragmatic of anybody in this situation. And to that extent, with Hirani sort of preoccupied with Ripley and with Narada and trying to get her back into shape, which Graz also spends a little bit of his time, just to insert that there, trying to help get Narada back to a working human being of some resolve.
Narada, by the way, not a big fan of the competition when it comes to Hirani's friendship.
I suspect. I imagine there's an awful lot of gum popping. Very like heated, just like,
yeah, it's that angry gum popping.
Your teeth with the gum between.
It's that scene. From The Simpsons where everybody's like, "What's that noise on the track?" And you just see Narada grinding her teeth.
With Iris again being the, like I said, the most sort of pragmatic of the group, the least emotionally invested in the sense of personal preservation, Graz kind of gets enlisted to help her shore up the defenses and basically get things ready in case something goes down in this immediate area. I would suspect then that those are the first two to really have most of this information, though all of you probably know it in some form or fashion. You've all been to Coruscant long enough to know that it is a planet of very vast contrasts, right? You've got the wealthiest of the galaxy citizens living in sparkling towers that rise up in the atmosphere. The poorest eke out painful lives down in polluted warrens. And somewhere in between that, too, is a dwindling middle class often preyed upon by denizens of both the heights and the depths of the planet. Do you get the allegory? Anyway.
Yeah, no, I think you do.
So the safe house that you guys are in exists basically in one of those tiny middle class zones. It is enclosed in one of these big sprawling apartment blocks, and it's just a small domicile unit there. The security is minimal when you arrive anyway. Basically, there are deadbolt door locks, and at least one or two guys is armed with a stun pistol, like roving guards, and that's pretty much it. That's all they've got. To a certain extent, that's by design, because they don't want to draw any more attention than necessary, but basically, they've made the best of what they have available. There are three apartments that have concealed doorways that are all connected with each other. One is used as basically the living area and barracks where you guys spend most of your time. Three bedrooms, they're small, they have few amenities, cots with military-grade blankets, and just the basics. The second center apartment is basically where everyone meets regularly to create plans of action. Those who are less educated than the others are learning skills you're not typically taught in school, especially Imperial ones. The three bedrooms there have been converted into a workshop, a computer room that has a small holonet transceiver, and an infirmary. And the workshop is also where they have kind of like a small armory stocked with a number of small arms and explosives, but most of them are untrained in using this stuff really effectively. The last unit is very disparate from the others. It is a sparsely furnished, pretty normal habitation. Little or nothing is out of place. And this is where the real genius of this comes into play. Taro Rescon has done a pretty good job here. This place is used for meetings with people who aren't members of the cell and for entertaining guests. Basically, if they're looking to bring somebody in, this is square one for them. There's actually a loyalist couple that lives there. And they pose as husband, well, they're a husband and wife, but they pose as good Imperial citizens. They work their day jobs, they act like everything is normal, and that's sort of the way that they keep everything under wraps. So that's what you're looking at in terms of the place that you've been staying and things that are ongoing over this course of 24 to 48 hours or so. And that's what you can kind of expect from there. Within a couple of days, basically, once you have gotten sort of to know the hosts and gotten accustomed to the people that are there, and they're from all walks of life. This is, if you've seen a big mixture of species at any point in time on Coruscant, this is it. The loyalists are not in a position to turn down anybody who's actually true to the cause. And so it matters not what species they're from. They're brought in and made a part of it. So people from all different walks of life. After roughly a couple of days, one morning, a call was put out through little messengers, which are mostly the little kids. Like anybody who has kids, they put the kids to work as messengers to kind of get messages to people around the compound. You're all called to the computer room. You're told that there is a message awaiting you from something called the Resurgence.
Nice.
So, once everybody has made their way there after, you know, a fairly standard morning, Caro actually is in play there, Cruzcog, and she proceeds to pull up a message. It's in text form, but you are assured that it is being delivered directly from the Resurgence from someone named Admiral Varth, and she believes that this is someone you should know. I'm going to place the message in the Discord for you guys if you'd like to read it, and then I will read it aloud for the rest of our listeners and viewers. So it reads, quote, "Excellent work. You've done quite a job exposing the Sarlacc project, and you have exceeded my expectations. By now, the Inquisitorius is running around like a swarm of angry Dantari fire ants. You've made quite an impression on them, and I doubt they'll underestimate you again. I know that I won't. As much as we'd like to see you off planet and out of danger, there is still a need for you to remain on Coruscant for a short while longer. Pavel Trenal, who had been forced to work as a designer for the Sarlacc project, has contacted us seeking asylum. Prior to being pressed into duty by the Empire, Trenal was a weapons technician for Incom, and in exchange for help, he's promised to tell us everything he knows about the offensive capability of the Sarlacc project. It's only a matter of time before the Empire realizes that Trenal's body is not among the dead, and they'll go looking for him. You should leave immediately and rendezvous with him. I'm providing a current holographic representation of Trenal with this transmission. He is currently staying in a flop house in one of Coruscant's sublevels, an area known as the Gnawer's Roost. It is a bad part of town, so stay on your toes. On the plus side, Imperial security tends to avoid the place as they are none too popular in that region. Good luck. I'll await your signal when you return, and then we'll see about getting you back to the Resurgence for some much-deserved downtime."
Yes, please.
And as you guys discuss that, I will bring up an image for you to see that, as he mentioned, he was giving you a holographic representation.
Pavel Trenal. Okay. I will say, Varth seems a little bit warmer, may not be the right word, but maybe a little bit pleased with our efforts.
He seems like a chatty Cathy. Hunter, did
probably
you get
him a few more times than I have?
Hunter, did Cody get his start on a show called Chatty Cathy?
I think it was actually Sassy Cathy was the name of the show that he got his start on. For the record, the representation of Frenal looked like this. It's in the Discord now.
Okay, that's just a dude straight from the old Republic game,
right?
Lindsay, am I right?
Dude, that is a Chris Evans looking dude from the old Republic.
Like, I legitimately recognize the armor he's wearing. I'm pretty sure my gunslinger had that exact armor.
Hey, it looks like he took all the stupid with him.
Wait, that looked like me.
Man, you ever see pictures of yourself and think, man, people used to let me go out of the house looking like that. Then you look in the mirror and you'd be like, damn, it's happening again.
Sometimes it'd still be like, I can hear Piney on my post.
Help me!
Help me! So, anyway.
Terrible.
Those of you, nobody's trained in knowledge except for Hirani, right?
General, yeah. How you talking? Just general knowledge? Or...
Wait, it's this. I don't know. I'm not cute. Go on.
Hirani, make me a knowledge check.
All right. I got to pull up all my sheets because I forgot to. God damn it. Look, on Call of Duty, you don't need a sheet.
I have the new ones. This galactic lore.
Yeah, I have the new ones. You have a plus 8 to knowledge.
I have a plus 8.
Oh, I called it Billy and the Clonosaurus.
Oh, you've got to be kidding. Oh, you've got to be kidding me.
Already.
Well, it's a skill check. So.
You don't know, Jack.
It is a skill check. You can't critically fail it. So Gnawer's Roost is not the sort of place you would have ever spent any time. You've probably heard the term once or twice, but you don't really know anything about it. Sort of, it's a nasty neighborhood. It's the kind of place where when Dad says he's got to go, he's got some nasty folks following him. He's got to go. Dad's got to go bye-bye, okay? that's where he's going.
He's going out to get some death sticks.
Yeah, it is very much the, you would imagine, you don't know, a pit of depravity. Probably the kind of place where the worst of the worst hang out. Street gangs, spice dealers, yeah, your death stick guys, smugglers, thieves, cutthroats, all of that. You know, well, you do know, even with a questionable role there, is that none of the people in your immediate vicinity, save for your crew, are going to be the kind of people who are seasoned enough to take on a place like that. You wouldn't trust any of these people to make it out with their lives, much less any of their belongings. So it is probably not in your best interest to add any of their numbers to yours if you're planning to go there.
I mean, you wouldn't trust a clown to fix the John.
That's right. That's what it is.
I like it when you call me big. Quick Hunter staring contest, me and you right now. You win. You always do.
Come on, come up here.
Robert Goulet. Anyway.
Anywho.
What would you like to do with this information?
What information? I love you, Shannon. Ronnie let us down.
Don't go there.
This message barked back. Can we not, though?
I feel like I need to do a gather information and see if I can figure out a safe way for us to get there.
Okay. That's something you can do. Or try.
That was very Chad. Okay.
Sick.
And this should be fun because my gather information is up to a plus 19 now.
Wow. Yeah. So you
don't think I could.
Yep.
Wow.
That's two, right, that's out of the gate.
That's two ones in a row, ladies and gentlemen.
Now ones. this is unrelated, but before I forget, I assume you guys just know you leveled up, you rested, any persistent conditions are gone, you're back in. Yeah. Okay, yeah. Good. That's still a one.
Fresh clean sheet.
Yes. All right. So Iris, you're not used to this. You're not used to being cut off from the outside world. And in such a way that you know good and well that stepping out the door is potentially a death sentence if you're not prepared for it.
Yep.
So your variation of gathering information, of picking up clues and listening to conversations and, you know, dropping a couple of credits here and there to get what you need to know, it's just not viable.
Yeah.
Not without too much risk to life and limb, basically. What you do know is getting to Gnawer's Roost in general is not that difficult. It's not the kind of place that taxis really want to go, but you could probably grease a couple of palms and a couple of wheels and get there. You know, it's that's all really worth knowing. You can figure out how to get there pretty easily, or at the very least a taxi driver probably can, or a pilot, technically a taxi pilot, I guess I should say. It's probably going to cost you a little extra than it would normally because that's not the kind of place that they want to go. And if you want to, right. And if you're wanting to avoid any further Imperial entanglements, then it's going to cost even more. It's not going to be cheap, but it's certainly not out of the question.
Gotcha.
But every measure that you can take to protect yourself is going to be necessary.
All right, let's go there and let's use protection.
Important safety tip. Thanks, Egon.
All right. That's from Michaela.
All right. So what's the plan here?
Don't get caught.
Yeah. I'm going to grease
on my heaviest cloak.
Look, guys, the Harani money train is running pretty thin at this point. Does she still get money for level ups, or that ended, right? Yeah, the gravy train's ended. So
yeah,
Harani
wealth only enacts when you garner noble levels.
Yeah, Harani's only rolling about 15,000 credits at this point. So let's grease some palms. But with Cody, you missed it. At one point, she had so much money, she bought a new ship. I mean, she won this tournament.
You say missed it. I listened to every episode. I know she had it.
Cody, please.
She bought a new ship. She got a jetpack. Got two droids. Got two blasters.
So you're basically it's pretty great. Game equivalent of what happens when you win the lottery.
Yeah,
she's Mike Epps in Resident Evil 2. My shit is custom. Like,
yeah, we'll grease some palms and make our way downtown. Of never mind, you know
what this is going. Faces pass. As far if you're wanting to use anything that the that's kept in the safe house, I mean, again, they've got a little workshop, a little armory that has like an inventory. I can tell you the sort of stuff that they have if you think any of it would be beneficial to you.
Yes,
but that's up to you. So in terms of the armory, they hold a couple blaster carbines, a few pistols, some holdout blasters. They do have one with a targeting scope on one of the rifles, power packs, energy cells. They're sitting on about 6 frag grenades that they managed to smuggle. They got a missile launcher, which is kind of nice, some explosive charges and timers.
No.
They even have some armor like blast helmets and vests. They got some jumpsuits. As far as non-combat stuff goes, well, they also do have some medical kits, med packs, you know, healing stuff.
I would like some medical kits, please.
Kits or med packs?
I guess both, because doesn't she use both? I could use med kits. Like
when you have a kit, you have a kit. It doesn't go anywhere.
Well, why the hell do I have... With your... That's weight, I thought it was a mount. I thought I had 19 med kits, and I'm like, why the hell do I have 19 med kits?
No, med kits are there. It's the sort of thing that adds to your treat injury check. Yes. You only need one of those, okay. And they don't stack.
I want
to
grab some.
They're sitting on 10 med packs. They would like meekly encourage you not to take everything, but whatever you need, you're the great Harani Tar. So
you have a Jedi with force treatment. You don't need as many anymore.
All right, keep them.
No, take one, maybe two.
I've 10. I've already got some, so I was just gonna replenish a little, but yeah, that's fine. If you can do it, you can do it.
My ass is the Lorax over here. I speak for the healing. It's fine.
Sigurd has been thinking that, you know, sometimes it'd be nice not to have to get into the middle of a bunch of enemies for combat. Maybe it'd be nice to have a blaster occasionally. Is there a blaster Sigurd could take?
Yeah, they got 4 standard blaster pistols.
Sigurd know how to use a blaster?
He's been there a time or two, I think.
No, that wasn't Sigurd.
Oh, according to Hunter, it was.
Oh, God.
Can't get away from it.
So we've got the great Harani Tar. We've got a Jedi who's carrying around his Red Ryder bolt-action BB gun.
Jesus Christ. Really?
Well, I mean, he's never shot one thermal detonator too. Still,
so. Yeah, I have a thermal detonator.
Kruskal's gonna stay. He
wishes not to be involved.
Come on, Zubat.
As far as like relatively mundane equipment goes, they've got some short and long range comm links. A couple of each. They've got some data pads. They got some electro binoculars, a couple pairs of those, glow rods, breath masks, liquid cable dispensers, a lot of just really kind of generic stuff, pretty much. And then they do have like
already in my bag.
Right.
They do have like some heavy cloaks if you're looking to disguise yourself, that kind of thing.
I'll take one of those, because I mean, I'm already a Twi'lek and I'm the world famous, or sorry, galaxy famous Harani Tar. I'm gonna need a cloak.
Graz's disguise is he takes his bandolier and he puts it on the other shoulder.
Yeah, that's a good call. That's a good call.
That's the disguise. He literally, like, he stares you dead in the eye as he goes.
We braid some of his fur.
Can he shave like a little goatee in instead of the full facial hair?
It's the reverse goatee. Yeah. So instead of growing one, he shaves out a beard.
Oh, that's a cursed image in my head. How do I delete images in my brain?
How do I delete other people's posts?
Oh, you put that in there. Hunter Hendricks, damn you. You put that in my head.
Oh, yeah, there's not much disguising a Wookiee, but fortunately for him, and I promise this isn't racist, they all kind of look the same. So, they all have very similar appearances. Right. I mean, he is still covered in dust, so, like, if you really think it's helpful, you can, you know, get some of it off and not all of it. Like, days later, this stuff is embedded in his fur. So, actually, he looks like a little salt and pepper Wookiee right now. He looks older to that extent, so maybe that's beneficial.
That's pretty good. Yeah, salt and Wookiee. Yeah, salt and Wookiee.
Salt and Wookiee.
You're gonna be able to find for the boy.
Boy.
Boy, I tell you what.
Hey, you been chasing cars tonight, boy? Boy.
Boy, you look no.
You look confused, boy.
Don't say that word.
You ready to join the army sagging backwards? Call of Duty reference. Don't sue me.
Sure.
Anyway.
My boss is listening to this show now. I gotta stop.
You do.
Yeah.
All right. So, what's the plan? How do you want to get to this place?
I mean,
taxi.
We don't want to take the broken speeder we are currently renting. May as well use what we're paying for. Not like we can take it back to the dealership.
Oh, that thing has long since been identified. Unless you want to stand out there with the world's largest file and get the serial number off over the course of a couple of days, that thing is a hotbed of... If you didn't already push that thing into the river, I don't know what the...
I was about to say, I was like, can we put the thermal detonator on that?
Crash to the planet.
I mean, if you recall, you did pay for the insurance, so you should be fine.
Oh, yeah. I mean, will they pay out the insurance to criminals? probably a future question. It's fine. Yeah, taxi. Oh. Very, very dark taxi.
No, you guys asked about them charging, like, your, you know, accounts for hotel rooms and stuff.
Sorry.
Sorry. Whatever you paid initially is done. Yeah, I mean, at this point, you're wanted criminals. They don't have that information. They don't have access to it. So they're not charging you anymore, but you're certainly not welcome to just waltz in the front door back there. Or, again, drive that speeder around.
Right, yeah.
It's not the best plan.
Yeah. The least well-sighted taxi driver we can find.
Yeah, dirty. All right. It's an oily fellow. You know the type. He walks over and says,
"He's oily, real oily.
You need a taxi."
Oily Josh and the Greasy Boys.
The non-clean taxi that no one wants to get in.
Yeah, you wait for, I don't know, you know, 15, 20 minutes, let a few of them go by, and eventually one that is in about the same condition as the speeder that you had before rolls by. And I do mean almost rolls. Like, this thing would be better on wheels than it would be on the jump jets that it's on. There is a scarred up Rodian who's driving, and he, like, rolls down the window and hits you with that, you know, "Onginta junta."
To be fair, the taxi did have the license plate said fresh, and it had dice in the mirror, so...
Main thing, we thought the speeder was fair.
I forgot, you forget your ho to Nars, whatever.
Roost.
That doesn't rhyme.
Yeah, he kind of jerks his head toward the back seat. There's room enough for everyone to cram in uncomfortably.
What does Rodian speak again? Is it specific to Rodian?
Rodian.
Okay.
Yeah, I think it's actually pronounced Rodian.
Gotcha.
Or I think it's called Rodian. I'm gonna check to make sure.
That's actually
no Rodice.
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 They speak Rodice. Yes.
All right. Well, Rodice.
He appears to be not interested in speaking basic. He understands it. He doesn't speak it. Okay, it's kind of like Kree and pirate code. He understands it. He can't speak it. Yeah. So he nods toward the back seat, and again, you can uncomfortably squeeze in there. Groz takes up so much space.
Right. He's monkey in the
middle.
He's
so big.
He almost wish we could lay him down and we just sit on top of
him. He does that thing where he gets in the middle and he spreads his arms across the back of the seat for everybody.
Almost going out the windows on both sides.
He's man-spreading uncomfortably. It's no good. It's real bad.
So many bus trips.
um, And so the Rodian seemingly asks again as he like taps his nav computer, trying to get your attention of like, where do you want to go?
Nar's roost, please.
So he takes off. You hear the like the engine just like roar to life. It sounds like the whole fucking Millennium Falcon taking off. But eventually he gets that bad boy going. And so you cruise on down the streets. I need for Kruskog and Sigurd to make me a couple of sense force checks, please.
He's also
enter use the force.
Use the force check. Yeah.
He's also blaring the most stereotypical Rodian
obnoxious
EDM music.
Yeah. Yes, yeah, it's painful.
He is,
and he's getting down to
it. Like, he's the alien version of like Euro trash.
More than once, he tries to say something and like kind of points at the speaker from where the music is coming from, and you can only assume he's saying, "I was in that. Like my cousin's in that band. I know that guy. I can get you a copy.
Get you in that club
of this if you want one. I'll get you in there.
One out of the glove compartment
for donations."
He says, "Well." He says, "Well, I didn't really actually know the lead singer of that band, but I knew a guy who did."
No, you didn't.
And, yeah, well, no, I didn't. But you can imagine. You can imagine.
31.
31? Sigurd, what do you got?
24.
Okay. Both of you know that within the next couple of blocks, in fact, it's like a premonition. It hits you both at the same time. There is a pretty strong Imperial checkpoint. We're talking about lat gunship on either side, like marked off areas. There will be no way to get through if your driver doesn't turn and turn soon and take an alternate route.
Hang right now. Please go.
He looks back. He actually kind of slows down because he's coming up on the Coruscant equivalent of a stoplight. So he has a second to basically make a choice here and looks back. Jinjunta? He's questioning your method.
Anywhere except straight.
Yeah, his hand goes up in that universal gesture.
Harani just...
extra 50 credits.
Harani lowers her head and just goes...
No, Kruskog's got cash, homeboy.
Never mind. Uncle Rich Uncle Money Jedi over there is going to take care of me.
Rich nothing. Comfortably middle class Kruskog.
Real quick. Hi,
You said, I'm sorry?
I forgot to put something down on my sheet earlier. My half level for my skills. What was that supposed to be?
It just goes up by one.
Half level.
Yeah, your half level went up by one. So your half level right now is six.
Okay.
I need to point out, Comfortably Middle Class Kruskog was my favorite replacement show for Fresh Prince of Bel-Air on NBC when it went off the air. It was a good show. It was a good show.
It only lasted three episodes.
They canceled it too early.
You know,
they canceled it so they could run that caveman show from the Geico guy.
I mean, they tried Tony Danza bringing him back. He was very bad as a boss. It just didn't play well.
Well, you hear who they had lined up for the next couple of episodes, didn't you?
It was Chong.
Yeah.
It was Chong who they had.
I didn't know we were going to do that or the Frank Stallone bit.
I am going to run it into the ground.
Gunna is carrying a lot of weight in that sentence, friend.
Anywho, your offer of 50 credits does not prompt him to put his hand down, and he just keeps it going. You can tell the light's going to change at any second.
150. 250.
Ding dong da. That appears to be the number that he wanted to hear. Effectively, he has doubled his fee for you. Yeah, but in doing so, he makes his turn and makes an effort to, you know, pretty much avoid that checkpoint. And he does so, in fact. He's able to effectively pilot from that point forward without running into any more Imperial presence as he makes his way down into Nar's Roost, or toward it, I guess I should say. As you guys arrive and you get out of the taxi, pay your fee. It's 150 credits total now. Kruskog, assuming you're paying that. This flop house you're looking for is deep in the heart of this area. Nar's Roost is an area in and of itself. First of all, the moment that you step out of the taxi speeder, another classic Star Wars line comes to mind. What an incredible smell you've discovered. It is decidedly funky. It's real bad. Foul smells and even fouler residents would be a good place to, or a good way to describe it. On the plus side, as described, the Imperial law enforcement has literally no presence here. There's not a stormtrooper helmet in sight, no comlinks constantly going off through helmets. Basically, the only rule in this place is that might makes right. You don't have to walk very far through just grimy streets to find this permacrete structure that has a flickering holographic display out front, which naturally advertises hourly rates. It's the sort of flop house you're looking for, and you would expect that this is the direction you've been sent. There are approximately, you, those of you who are mostly combat oriented, especially Groz would count quickly, 7 tough looking youths outside the Utes. They're hanging outside. Each of them has similar like attire colors specifically, and they're just sort of loitering around the entrance. They all have begun sort of hungrily eyeing you guys. You notice they do this to pretty much anybody who passes. For the record, how are you guys currently presenting? Like, Irani, you're like full-on cloak, hiding as best you can?
Mostly over her head, so she hides the lake crew and everything. Also, Irani knows these youths. She's heard of them before. This is a bad group. This is War Wreck. She knows them.
Let's get to spitting.
It's hammer time.
Why be a hammer or nail when you can be a muff hammer? I'm sorry,
what about the rest of
the dude throwing hammers into the bush is the dumbest thing I've seen in years, and yet I can't shake it.
Yeah, the longer you watch him, one of them actually holds up a door so the other one can drop kick it in midair. One of them crawls out from under the flop house. He's quickly identified as the Pale Mamba.
That's Chief East. That's Chief East. Oh, yeah. One of the more dangerous ones.
One of them is breathing extra heavy, and it's not because he's got a breath mask on.
That's the word, son.
That's
word.
That's downtown Charlie Brown.
Yeah. Oh, so, how are the rest of you presenting? Harati, you're pretty well, covered up, right?
Yes.
Okay.
I've got my cloak on, but rather than having my hood pulled way down far on my face, I've got my goggles down over top of my eyes.
Okay.
Fair enough. No. Any weapons on display?
No, they're hidden.
Okay.
Cruzco got his pulled down like Jay-Z with a flat bill. It's just right above the eyes. Me. Enough for him to see, and that's it.
He's got 99 problems.
And these guys are several.
Being a Sith.
Groz's general presence seems to be enough to give them pause to accost you, but the fact that you look relatively non-threatening beside him is enough for a little bit of verbal abuse to get thrown your way. There's some, think Jay and Silent Bob, the sort of stuff they would yell at you from outside of the convenience store. That's the kind of stuff that gets hurled in your direction. It's not good for Facebook, so I'm not going to say it. But that's the kind of stuff that gets yelled at you. Yeah.
Accosted by youths.
Yes.
We just go about our business and ignore them.
Okay. Well, being that this is the place that you need to go, how would you like to go about ignoring it? Are you just going to walk straight in?
Kinda. That's what, if they're just being little punk asses, I just want to walk right past them. Let's alert way through.
Let Groz walk first.
Yeah.
Well, as you, so Groz will basically take a position right behind you. I mean, he's pretty much dogging your heels at this point. Of the 7 of them, like a couple try to step in front of the doorway. Like, hey, what are you doing here? Haven't seen you around here. Like that kind of stuff. Groz hits him with a like just as deep as he can, and he is not great at intimidation, but we're gonna see what happens. It's a persuasion based skill, right? Yeah, he's getting +4 to persuasion. Poor Groz. He's just so non-threatening.
He's a teddy bear.
We're gonna try though. Aww. We're gonna try. We're gonna see what happens. Nope.
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 Well,
nope.
Can Cruzco give it a try?
Not He's not scary at all, and basically in doing so, like, a little bit of the dust, like, shakes off of his fur, and so they kind of start laughing. As a matter of fact, a couple of more of them come over now. Oh, well, you got your teddy bear with you? Is that who he is? They're looking less and less concerned about any of you.
I would like to do this.
Okay, what's this? What are we doing? What are you doing?
I'm going to, I'd like to persuade them not to bother us.
Okay.
And using my magical new talent, I'm going to use my use the force modifier instead.
Talent. Boggle.
Part of me wants to take 10 on this, but that's not going to apply since this is going to be opposed.
Boggle.
I almost did anyway. It teetered from 10 to 8, so I've got a 27.
Okay.
I'm persuading them not to bother us.
You're right, it is an opposed roll, so... Yep. Oh, yeah. So what do you do?
Almost went into the Cosby voice. The youths with the music and the...
Play the kids today. They don't know about the Gnar's roost.
And the war.
The whole, whole.
Simply going to look at them and say, you probably wish to bother people with greater means than ours. We are here simply to make a brief stop, acquire what we desire, and move on. I would rather not trouble ourselves or you with any kind of quarrel that may draw any untoward attention. So if you would please step aside, I'm sure you have larger prey to hunt, and we have better things to do.
So as you first start talking, like, there's like laughter going up through the group. They think you're hilarious. They're not at all intimidated by you whatsoever. As a matter of fact, they're laughing at, like, a couple of times you say things that rhyme and it sounds inadvertent, and they kind of like titter and mention it. But while you're talking, you move your cloak aside inadvertently just to kind of, you know, we're going to move past you here. And in doing so, the light whip that's coiled at your side becomes visible. And at that, the eyes of the two guys in the front go wide, and they immediately go, "Jeez, it, boys, it's the Feds!" It's that, basically. They both go, "Oh, our mistake," and they book it in either direction. They split right down the middle and pretty much go running around the sides of the building. It's not to play your character, but it's a very, like, "Was it something I said?" sort of moment.
I want it to be
whatever it is. It worked.
I want it to be Raph in Ninja Turtles 1, where he pulls back the trench coat and shows the side, but it is very much not that smooth for Coruscant.
Yeah, no, it is. It's completely inadvertent. Like, based on what he said versus what happened, oh, they're intimidated. It just had nothing to do with the words that he had to say. Basically, it looked like any show of being well healed was enough for them to go, "Oh, we're good."
Yeah.
Like, you imagine, in the aftermath, you imagine these punks are probably sporting, like, vibro daggers at best, probably regular daggers. You know, maybe, like, an old busted-up blaster that they lifted off of a dead body somewhere. Not much, pretty much. So, yeah, in any case, they split. They split the scene. The double doors to the hotel enter directly into a lobby that is cluttered with garbage and junk, and just, it is clearly not well maintained. This looks like the entrance to, like, an unmaintenanced parking garage, not somewhere that you would go to stay the night. There is a clearly abused 3PO model droid, corroded gray metal that is covered in graffiti and grime on him, and he is behind a scarred and stained counter. Every surface around him is filthy. Torn chairs leaning up against the walls, a thin metal counter that's covered in, like, flimsy paper, basically, and food packets. The droid, one of his eyes glows dully and occasionally flickers. The other one is completely dark, and it's unlikely he can see through it in any way, shape, or form. And as a matter of fact, as you come upon the front desk there, I need anybody who's now in the room, I need a perception check, please.
Perception.
Am I in the room? I'm it's a long story.
Assuming everybody is making their way in.
Yeah. Well, didn't see the die roll, but that's a 26.
I got 24.
Okay. Oh, I should roll one for Kraz.
24.
Okay. Yeah, he's not doing so hot. Sigurd, what about you?
I'm trying. Give me a second. My shit is trying to freeze up on me.
I mean,
tell him not to.
Rotation, yeah.
Perception.
Mm-hmm.
22.
Okay. Kruskog then got the highest number. So you're the first to notice, but anybody who's literally everybody but Graz, who rolled over a 20, does eventually notice that. First, Kruskog, you specifically only notice that there is actually a name tag emblazoned. It's like where you would put a restraining bolt on the 3PO. He is designated OT-3PO. The rest of you all also eventually notice from behind the counter that the droid himself is chained to the floor. He has, like, manacles around his feet, and he is connected to the ground. It's not clear if this is to prevent his escape or to prevent him from being stolen. Or a little from column A, a little from column B. Who knows? Either way, once you all sort of make your way into the lobby, the droid does pipe up in a very standard 3PO forced cordiality and says, you know, ah, hello, how may I be of assistance?
I gotta order pizza for Bob, apparently, so you guys gotta figure this out for a second.
What?
I ordered a lot of movies on Bob's tab, and he's calling in a favor. That is a true story.
Oh my gosh.
He's not wrong.
What a story, Mark.
Post-podcast, because I'm very curious about how that arrangement came about. But
now, we don't have time to unpack all of that.
Not right now. No, Kruskog will walk up and I talk to the droid specifically and say, hello, we are seeking a tenant at your facility here. Perhaps a name you've heard previously.
And who might that be?
That would be one Pavel Trenal.
Ah, yes, Mr. Trenal, I can tell you where to find his room for a price. After all, the requested information is confidential as per the clause of our establishment's rental agreement. But for a small fee, as stated, payable in standard credits, the clause can be waived.
Here's 100 credits.
Okay. He will gladly accept 100 credits for that information.
Like 50, okay.
I'm not in the mood to haggle.
he will gladly accept your bribe of 100 credits there, Sigurd. And so then to you specifically, he will tell you after accessing information where you see one of his eyes go dark and flicker rapidly for a moment, which is very weird because it's like he's blinking really fast. That Trenal's room is located in Unit 5212, five floors down. The fifth sublevel is accessible by turbo lift or the stairwell, and he kind of generally gestures to his left. It was very obvious that that was the only direction for you to go. Right. That part is extremely unhelpful.
Thank you for your assistance. We'll be going.
Yes, of course. And as you're walking away, it's like he kind of keeps sort of trying to talk to you, pulling against the chain on the floor with his foot. He says, oh, this infernal thing. It's not as if I would wander off. Doesn't anyone trust me? The implied answer, of course, is no. Clearly, they do not.
Harani's
I want to drop the gatekeeper on him and be like, when all things are done, you'll be free.
Harani wants to ask him why they chained him up in the first place, and she does it in binary. Because she can do that.
Fancy.
Now, can you? That's a good question. Having binary, does that mean you can speak binary or just that you can understand binary?
Why can't I just go like bleep, bloop, bloop, bleep, bleep? They do it.
Because that's what she would be like, what'd you say about my mama?
Man, everybody speak robot. I said some stuff to that robot. Private stuff.
Private things. Let me check that for sure. Okay, yes, you cannot speak binary. You understand binary, but you cannot speak.
Man, everybody understand binary. That's not new.
No, literally
zero and
one. No, they don't. Yeah, that is not That is not the case. No, a living being who understands binary cannot understand the same volume of information as another droid or a computer, and you also cannot speak it, basically.
Man, okay, so just quick out of character, the force technique I debated on getting was language absorption, which, depending on how they do that, you can retain the ability to speak and understand the language for 24 hours.
I would still not give that for binary, because really, there is an entire... So there's a book called The Scavenger's Guide to Droids, just to briefly pull back the curtain. And there's a talent you can take. It's a scavenger secret, like as part of the scavenger prestige class, where you can learn to speak binary, where it's basically like whistles and chirps and stuff. Right. To me, that having its own separate thing means that, I wouldn't make it part of anything unless you literally took that.
So,
you can understand it. You cannot say it to him in binary. But yeah, you're welcome to ask why he is chained to the floor. And he more or less repeats himself, basically just saying that he doesn't know why. He's plenty trustworthy. He's never given anyone any reason to be otherwise. As a matter of fact, he can't even fall asleep around this place without someone drawing a name on him. And he kind of just generally gestures to all the graffiti and stuff.
We'll be right back. We'll see how this goes.
I'm going to suggest we take the stairs, because I don't know that I trust that the lift has maintenance in the current state of this building.
I agree.
You are right to assume that. The turbo lift, you can tell without even hearing or seeing it move, because it doesn't seem like there's anybody around in the immediate vicinity. It is rickety at best. Rickety would be a nice word to describe it. On the other hand, just for the record, the stairwell is it's best described as perpetually moist.
Yeah.
And quite gloomy. Yeah, it is. I'm not going to make you make checks or anything, but you do have to.
I'd rather slip than fall to my doom straight down.
You constantly have to weigh the advantages and disadvantages of, do I touch this railing and wonder what that was furry on it? Or do I hope that the steps are not so slippery I'm going to break my neck going down the next 10? But eventually and safely, and Shannon, I'm assuming after the first three, you want them to let you know so you can throw up, right?
Yes.
Even though you're going down instead of up, because the smell only gets worse the further down you go.
We're definitely
breath mask will not impede that at all.
Boy, if only if only Harani could get space COVID where she can't smell or taste. Like Shannon has had regular COVID and can no longer.
Basically, you're able to make your way down the five floors, down to the sub-level. It is quiet. That's a nice way of putting it. It's like eerily too quiet. There's really nobody around. Any little sound you hear here and there can't possibly be anything good. Metallic clanks and mechanical whirs of, like, stuff that's clearly not running properly like it should. You search up and down the hallways, which are all pretty much identical, to find eventually room 5212. The door is very clearly just a thin alloy. It's covered in a peeling wood veneer, like they tried to make it sort of nice. But other than that, there's nothing descriptive about it. Nothing worth writing home about.
Who wants to knock? Who's the one that knocks? Oh God! No!
No, God! We're not here.
Subtlety. What's the thing that you call subtlety?
And he just kind of like does this and then backs up.
And Shreebook,
there's no response for the record.
And Shreebook, he said, "FBI, open up."
Is there a way to pick this door lock? Or like we hack into it, or
he hit you with that super bad? I assume you all have guns and crack. Sigurd, to your question, there is a mechanical lock on the outside if somebody wanted to try to pick it. You try to force it or something.
What's the skill? What skill?
It'd be mechanics.
Yeah, I'm on it. Harani is...
Okay, as you move in to do that, before you make that mechanics check, do me a favor and make a perception check.
I'm about to make a my stomach hurts check.
I keep... Listen checks in this module, and I'm like, listen is not a talent in this. Where the hell do they get listen? Anyway, I'm not crazy, right? Listen is not a skill.
No. Noah.
Yeah, I don't know why that's a thing.
26.
I don't know. That's weird. Okay. As you get in close to the door, before you start to pick, I mean, obviously you're going to be very close to it, so your ear basically ends up right against the door. Inside, you can hear what sounds like a standard, but an old, like, holovid unit. It's like somebody left the TV on, basically. Sounds like pod racing scores, like something really mundane. But beyond that, you don't hear any voices and you don't hear any movement.
I'm going to relay that information to the team. Something's on in there. He may be in there, or he may not be in there, if you know what I mean. So be ready.
Sure.
Hands on weapons. You don't have to pull them out, but get them ready.
Graz goes back for his bowcaster, basically ready to pull it around.
Yep.
I got my hand on my handle of my blaster.
I hold one single lightsaber out of my, I have it like in my sleeve.
26 again.
26. Quickly, I'll come back to that. Sigurd, you got those lightsaber. That's your where your quick draw holsters are anyway, right? In your Jedi robes,
you keep them. Yeah, but I'm saying it's out of my holster.
Sling them out. Into the hand. Oh, you're like holding on to it. Okay, I got you.
And Sigurd, aren't you missing like two fingers, and the lightsaber just comes out through there? Like it just. That'd be cool. That'd be really cool.
Look. As an aside, I hate that they got rid of that. That was one of the coolest things about Assassin's Creed. You got to give up a finger to get that blade. That's fucking dope. Yeah. Like, keep that going. I hate that.
You would like the demon hunters in World of Warcraft. They all have glowing green eyes. You know why they have glowing green eyes? Because as part of becoming a demon hunter is you have to stab out your own eyes so you can see the demons.
Yes.
Hell.
Yeah.
I love it.
Metal as hell.
You had a 26 on that mechanics check, right?
Yes.
Yeah, this lock is poor. I mean, this is... Not that you just destroyed it or anything, but yeah, you may as well have. Anybody who's ever attempted to reverse engineer a lock through mechanics would look at this and go, this is like play school, right? Like, you just move a couple wires and it's done. There's next to nothing to it. The door slides open uneventfully. Inside, from where you are, you can see that it is dim and dark, and there is indeed like a holovid unit on. There doesn't appear to be anybody inside immediately.
Can we look? I want to look around, see any signs of anything.
Okay. Make a perception check. Anybody who's going to go in and look around and make a perception check.
Me first.
Staying outside the door specifically.
I'm going in.
21.
I'll have Graz do one.
Wait, no, that was Tanner. I got 14.
I got a 20.
Okay.
I got a rock.
Was that everybody? Did I miss somebody?
That should be everybody. Everybody but Coruscant.
He's waiting outside. He's staying. Yeah, he's being lookout.
Yeah. Oh, he's staying outside. Okay, got you. Given that Graz sucks at perception, why don't you two switch places? He'll
one of us.
You.
Okay, me.
He'll stay outside and watch. Pretty much, he pokes his head in, looks around, and is just like,
looks like a room. Yeah.
So he goes back out and takes his vibro axe out and goes full Gamorrean guard and basically just stands by the door.
Well, 16. So
if anyone shows up, he's going to yell Wimitanye.
Wimitanye.
That Shreebook for
that is his last button.
That boy.
Wimitanye.
Okay.
Wimitanye. Here come that
anybody
boy.
Who got a 15 or better. Okay, first, literally everybody, because nobody rolled below 10, right?
No.
Yeah.
Okay, so first of all, you all, once the lights are on, notice that this is, as expected, a poorly furnished, what could be very graciously described as a hotel room. It's only, about 15 by 15 in any given direction. The carpet is fraying, the wallpaper's peeling just like the veneer on the door. There's an adjoining refresher, like a bathroom, basically, that smells of mildew. Fortunately, it's only mildew. There is indeed a single holovid unit that's set into the wall. It is indeed blaring out podcast race results. You now know that, Hirani, the reason that you noticed it specifically is that it is alternating between Huddies and Basic. And you're getting both. Basically, you're getting it in stereo. You hear one thing and then you hear it again, but you understand both of them effectively. And the bed itself is sagging from age and from use, basically. It's empty. It is a bit chaotic. The covers are thrown about, but there's nobody in the immediate vicinity. It's pretty clear, too, that nobody's there. Anybody who got a 15 or better also happens to sort of simultaneously notice that the only thing that seems really out of place, other than this is a lived-in, you know, generously described hotel room, is there's a scrap of, like, flimsy paper, basically, not a data pad or something, and it's on top of the holovid unit. Written on it is, like, in weird scrawling handwriting, is the phrase "invisible hand." Anybody who has, well, Harani, and then Kruskog, you have knowledge of galactic lore.
I do.
Anybody else have galactic lore?
I does.
Okay. Anybody with a knowledge galactic lore or general knowledge, make a check.
+12, 34
Oh, that's a nat 20 for Lindsay. God damn it! Stop rolling at the same time as me. I got 17.
Sorry.
24.
I have 34.
Lindsay got a nat 20.
It's a skill check.
Yeah, but she still got the high number. It's true.
I mean, the good news in this case is the good or bad news, depending on how you look at it. Yeah, yeah.
Nerd.
Basically, you figure it out quick. She's a what?
She's a nerd.
No, we're not doing this. We're not doing this right now. Iris, you figure it out a little quicker than everybody else, but eventually you all arrive at the same result. The phrase "invisible hand" sticks in your mind. This sounds vaguely familiar. And all at once, from, you know, varying walks of life, Kruskog probably from your schooling, Hirani probably maybe from the same deal, Iris just from traveling the galaxy, maybe from stories from your parents. The invisible hand was the name of a flagship during the Clone Wars, specifically General Grievous's flagship. But it was destroyed a long time ago during the Battle of Coruscant. It has long since not been a thing.
Hello there.
So, what that means is questionable at best, but that is where you recognize simultaneously that that's where the phrase is from. Beyond that, there doesn't appear to be anything else of interest or importance in the room.
Okay, I guess I would ask, do they maybe have wreckage of the invisible hand here on Coruscant? Is there
good question?
Can I check for that? Can I download a hoagie?
You wouldn't download a pizza.
Well,
I would if I could.
I would, and then maybe it wouldn't have cost me $17 to shut Bob's ass up.
You're welcome to make like a general knowledge check on the holonet if you would like.
Yeah, I'll do that.
Okay,
that's something I can.
So we'll make that a used computer check.
Thank you, because I just upgraded that. I appreciate that.
Yeah, you just refocused again, didn't you?
I am a skill monkey. That's what I do.
Woohoo! There you go. See, you got one too.
38.
Okay.
I know everything.
Yeah, I mean, pretty well. You're able to tap into it. It's like just the right Google search, just the right combination of quotation marks and comma setoffs and all that sort of stuff. To the extent that, do you get a straight answer? Not specifically, but certainly something that leads in that direction. There's a lot of discussion, a lot of like conspiracy theorist sites and stuff discussing how the ship went down, it was destroyed. A lot of stuff is very specifically known. What remains of it is questionable at best, but the phrase is often used in sort of underground circles, and it's kept quiet. It seems like anybody who was loyal to the Separatists at that time very much reveres the invisible hand like it was this, you know, this great. It's kind of like still thinking the Titanic was really cool, you know, even though it failed on day one. So certainly, if anybody could get their hands on any pieces of it, they would probably make use of it to their benefit. But specifically, is that a yes or no answer? No. There's no telling.
Okay, so is there any conspiracy theorists that we could try to talk to who might be able to help us that information out? Or is there any hints on the dark hollow net about where that could possibly be?
Web.
Yeah.
Not as best you can tell. Short of the information that you have, you know, it's very likely that if that stuff exists as memorabilia somewhere, it's on Coruscant and it's around, but has anybody done anything with it? Is it being traded quietly? I mean, it's just, there are too many possibilities to really effectively search for it.
Kruskog, do you know anything about this?
I know the name. I have learned about it in times past, but in terms of its present location or anything beyond a rumored loss of the ship in battle, I have no knowledge.
Maybe our people back home will know. Or we could also keep looking.
Varth knows many a thing. If there's someone we could utilize as an asset at some point, perhaps it is he.
Okay. But I say we also, is there anything else here we could look at? You know, any other clues?
There doesn't appear to be anything else of interest. Unless you'd like to lay in a rumpled bed or use a mildy bathroom.
No.
Mildewed. Moldy.
Let's go back out to that droid and ask him.
Yeah, we need to find out if anyone else has visited in the last few days.
Mm-hmm. We're going to go back to Mr. Okay. Droid. Okay.
Okay. So that's
sick.
Okay. I keep doing it unintentionally. So that's basically what you want to ask him, like, hey, what else can you tell us about the room, that sort of thing?
I would say what else can you, who has anyone been here other than us? And then also ask about the invisible hand, and Harani wants to, I don't know if through persuasion or what, make it very clear that if he can help us, then she's really good with lockpicking and freeing droids from their current predicaments.
His initial response is, the requested information is confidential as per the clause of our establishment's rental agreement. However, for a small fee or an agreeable compromise payable in standard credits or release, and he keeps glancing down with his one good eye at his leg, that clause could be waived.
Look, robots, stop beating around the bush and tell us what we want to hear and I'll let you out. That's the rules. Scout's honor.
Pretty much his continued response, without me just coming up with new phrases every time, you give me what I want, and then I'll give you what you want.
All right. I push Harani out of the way, walk around the counter with my lightsaber, and cut the chain.
Okay.
And the droid runs.
It's time to bring it back. Hunter, you ready for it? Arizona City. Yeah. Excuse me while I whip this out.
Bless it. Fortunately for Sigurd in this particular case, so he cuts the chain. There's this, cinematically, we would like cut from face to face and then eventually land on the droid. And there's a long pause on his one blinking eye. And then he says, wonderful. Now to that information, he says, I cannot tell you where Trennel is because I don't know. What I can tell you is that he did leave hours ago in the company of several rough looking Quarren.
Did you recognize these Quarren at all?
Not at all. He makes no attempt to move, for the record. He's quite content to tell you what you wanted. He got what he wanted, so he really has no reason to not share this information.
What about the invisible hand? Does that ring a bell?
He pauses for a minute and kind of like angles his head to the side, and then that eye starts going again. Harani, you would recognize this as he's searching the holonet himself and looking for some information. He comes back and gives you the boilerplate stuff about, General Grievous' ship, and it went down to the Battle of Coruscant and all that, and then he says, just a moment. Searches for a second and comes back and says, in this instance, I believe the invisible hand refers to a cantina. For a small fee, I could provide you with the directions.
How much is a small fee?
What do you got?
Okay, that's not the question.
He doesn't say that. I'm saying that.
He's a robot. Okay, he has to speak in absolutes.
I'm going to ask the droid if would he like payment, or would he like to be able to leave this place and just come with us?
Yeah. He's fairly independent at this point. He pretty much just wanted a way to get out of here, and he couldn't do it himself, but now he needs to be able to get further away, so he needs the money.
100 credits.
How about this? How about this? You tag along with us and help us, and we'll get you all the way out of here. We'll get you off the planet.
We got a guy on a ship somewhere around the way that we couldn't prove that out to either. Chris Call's going to give that
Jonah Hill. He stops and starts searching some information and comes back again and says, I don't believe that any of you are in any position to relieve me of Coruscant anytime soon.
It's going to sound weird, but I'm
you all look very somebody. Familiar.
Sigurd, I will tell them to go stand down in front of his house, okay? 100 credits. Here you go. Where's it at?
Yeah, give me 1 second.
He'll accept your 100 credit bribe, and he'll give you basic directions, pretty much to the invisible hand.
Yeah, I have money, so I send him a pizza.
Excuse me, or at least what he believes it to be. It is located elsewhere in Nars Roost, which would explain why you had such a difficult time finding anything out about it, because it doesn't exactly have a website to promote its daily deals, you know? It's very much an underground sort of place, but yeah, he can tell you exactly how to get there. It's about a 20-minute walk from where you are, moving at a reasonable pace. He doesn't recommend bothering with a taxi because there's really not any point in that. He'll tell you everything you want to know about how to get there and what to do.
That's what I'm interested in.
Okay. He's not going to leave until you guys leave, basically. It's pretty clear that OT does not want to be followed. He doesn't want anybody to know where he goes now that he's free. He'll offer a very curt thanks, pretty much, for letting him go, but he's waiting until everyone's out of sight so he can slip away quietly.
I will quickly look at him and say, you slip away quietly, we slip away quietly.
Good. We're in agreement, then.
Stellar. Farewell. Yeah, that's all Kruskog wants to know. If he's staying hush, we're staying hush.
Okay, what would you like to do?
Are there any cameras inside the lobby of that Nars Roost?
No.
Harani, cool. Can you wipe that droid's memory?
You're right.
I guess I'm going to wipe this droid's memory.
I mean, he's tottering away at this point, basically.
Hold on, she chases him down with her flashy thingy.
You flashy thing me, Harani.
Kruskog's got a skill that can take care of droids. Just know that that's something in his back pocket at all times now.
No, let the Wookiee win. It's fine.
No, Kruskog is going to again pull down the cloak hood and start making his way in the direction that we were instructed.
Let's
whatever any of them said. I missed the past couple minutes, so
he told you he believes the invisible hand is a cantina, and he told you where to find it.
Okay, let's roll.
That's the gist of it. So you make your way through the streets. Again, it's exactly what you experienced when you showed up. Less gangs, more just like lots of side-eyeing. But then again, everybody pretty well in this place side-eyes each other at any given point in time. 20-minute walk, not the most fun walk of your life, but mostly uneventful until you show up outside what looks like, again, little more than a rundown tenement. And once again, the only indication that there's anything here other than maybe a weird little apartment complex, especially that there's a cantina here, is a hexagonal sign in flickering blue neon. Most of you would recognize this as reminiscent of the Confederacy emblem that fought in the Clone Wars. Yeah, the Clone Wars, they're not flying the rebel flag. Slow down. Blue, not red, blue, and white.
Gotcha.
I can't wait for somebody to come out and go, yee.
Where's Piney?
They'll tell you that it's heritage, not hate. That's what it's all about.
Piney runs the place. This is his joint.
This is Piney's place. This is where he disappeared.
Howdy, y'all. It's been a while.
Once again, as you approach, there's a set of pretty steep stairs, clearly slippery with like moldy dampness, that lead down to the entrance. You can also see from your like elevated position that there is a single Quarren standing guard at the door. He's fairly relatively like nicely dressed. Looks like a bouncer, basically. The kind of guy who's like keeping an eye out for trouble.
That would be us.
You didn't even know that.
And we're just walking in to have a drink, that's all. Probably.
I'd like to approach the bar and order a beverage.
You gotta get in the place first.
Chief.
So I said we're just walk up to it. We're gonna go buy a drink. Oh, hey, what's up, man?
The Quarren, the bouncer, or at least he looks like a bouncer. He leans outside the wall there, or on the wall outside there. Now that you're up closer, you can see, he's like stylish for the most part, but it's like cheap material. Like he's ordering those clothes off of Wish.com. He examines all of you with what is a practiced gaze. He gives you the ocular pat down. It's pretty clear he's been doing this for a while. He has a stern expression for a Quarren. I mean, it's all tentacly. Eventually, once he's given you all the once over, he only stoically says, mind your manners, and then steps aside so that you can enter.
Fair
enough. Off there, and off he goes.
She tells him he looks nice as she walks by.
He does not react at all. Just past the sentry there, this leads into the cantina, there is a large smoky room, and it is cluttered with tables and chairs. There's a bar to your left fashioned with sheets of like chromed metal, and it appears to be hosted by a weirdly looking Gran in stained overalls. Gran is the name of this race if you want to look them up. Mm-hmm. Sitting in front of him at the bar are two Trandoshans. They're near the end of the bar. They appear to be chatting amicably in their very sort of sibilant, you know, tongue.
Stay away from the bar.
Their drinks are gathering condensation in front of them as they seem to be talking more than drinking. And then past the bar in the dimmest part of the cantina, like basically directly in front of you, but a pretty good distance down the long room, there are five humanoids seated around a table covered with empty mugs. Four of the shapes look to be Quarren, and they stand as you enter and they get an eye on you, black eyes intent upon you. The fifth shape is a relatively familiar looking human who stays seated. His hands are very carefully placed on the tabletop in front of him. Quickly make a perception check once again, everyone, please.
Dirty 20.
20.
Twenty-six. 13.
That's five under par.
Okay. So no. So everybody but Hirani, first of all. Well, okay, first of all, everybody. The mixture that kind of hangs in the air in this place is not just smoke. You would all recognize it as like incense, and it's very likely it's a Quarren incense. Like they're fairly well known for like pungent and aromas and stuff. Likely several of these substances are not legal. The walls are hung with flags, old separatist recruitment posters and war memorabilia. All of you, having garnered the knowledge that Hirani did earlier, also notice that there are pieces of alloy that are hung here and there all over the room with reverence. They have like little plaques and under them and stuff. And purportedly, these are fragments of the hull of the original Invisible Hand, which fell to the ground when it crashed during the Battle of Coruscant. So, hence the name of the place. You all know that much. The rest of you also notice, what were the other checks? Hirani got a 13 and then 20 and
26.
26. Okay, so actually it's only you, Iris, who notices that the fifth character at that table is a human and something's up. He looks out of place, like he's pretending to be someone or something that he isn't. The rest of you do notice, however, what you can make out of him from that direction is that it suddenly clicks. He looks like the sort of blurred holographic image that Varth sent you of this Pavel Trenal. And it's just as this all clicks in and as Iris kind of dead eyes this part of the room that the Quarren start walking from the table. One of them barks out a command in his language and the four of them start to spread out and reach for their weapons. And that is where we stop for tonight.
Boo.
That's it. That's all we got for the Star Wars.
Quarrens are right. Filthy, filthy people. Disgusting.
Oh, guys, as always, thank you so much for tuning in and for joining us for the show tonight. If this is your first time, you picked a great time to start the beginning of episode 7 here, A Reckoning of Wraiths, and we will be back next week with the second installment of this episode. But of course, you can go back and catch up on almost a year's worth of Star Wars adventures plus lots of others from PZ85 Plays over at podzilla1985.com right now. Shannon, what's going on the rest of this week?
Well, we didn't do a show last night.
No, we didn't. We played Call of Duty.
Eventually. What did I do? I don't remember what I did. It doesn't matter.
You got in there.
We got in there eventually. Tomorrow, though, we do we do have an all-new episode of I Want After Dark. And Lindsay's got some fun things planned for us. She said she's got a drinking game that involves nudity, goats.
No. Oh.
Also, tomorrow is Wednesday.
Uh-huh.
So you're a liar.
That show will be Thursday.
Oh, sorry. Tomorrow's the pro wrestling comedy hour featuring Asa and the Snitch. That'll be tomorrow. Thursday is an all new After Dark, and then Friday it is horse related comedy hour.
Ooh, maybe not for me this week. I have visitors this Friday, so okay. I will probably dip. I'll try to jump in Thursday so that I get my weekly.
All right, well, in that case, this Friday it's the Kaz hour right here on Podzilla 1985. That's right. Kaz.
What's different between that and horse time? Really,
Kaz it's will be just going
there's,
nuts.
There's more animation.
I mean, I might be here, but I don't know yet. We'll see. We'll see what's going on. I'll talk to you later about
and
that.
And then Saturday will be nothing. I did. You know what's funny?
It's Saturday.
I legitimately recorded a full-length hour episode of No Going Back last week, and I didn't post it.
You went
no,
back.
No, why?
You went back.
Because he thought better of it after the fact.
Yeah, so for an introductory episode, I wanted to give an explanation of why I'm doing it, why I want to cover serious topics. And even though it's not what you think, I didn't like go hard on certain past relationships, which is what I normally regret and then take away from the posting. It's just once I recorded it and I was getting ready to post it, Kaz messaged me and he said, "What are you up to?" I told him, and he said, "Well, you are something like you are known for sharing things," and I thought, I don't want to be known for that,
what?
So I canceled the episode, completely removed it. So whenever we do finally do the official first episode, it's just going to be a straight up episode. There's no personal information
that's
thrown
fair.
In. So cancel that episode. Lost episode. Another.
But then next week we're back to it.
Yeah.
And again, next Tuesday night, the next installment of episode 7, A Reckoning of Wraiths. Now, I will also briefly mention before we go that, as we alluded to earlier, 2 weeks from now, we have next week's episode, and then the following week we will likely be off completely. But I will, when I return the next week, I'll tell you all about, I'm going to actual Star Wars. I'm going to Disney. We're finally a year later getting to go and check out Galaxy's Edge, so I'm going to take lots of pictures, and it'll be fun, and I'm absolutely not doing a show on there. So
hang up on this Mickey happening. Mouse.
And then when we come back, we'll continue it from there. So, but yes, for now, be prepared. Next week, the second installment of Episode 7, A Reckoning of Wraiths and the Dawn of Defiance campaign. Guys, once more, thank you so much for joining us. Until then, for Shannon, for Lindsay, for Tanner, and for Cody, I am your Game Master Double H. May the Force be with you, and we'll see you next Tuesday. Later.